I can't hit him a lick. I ain't doing my duty by that boy, and that's the Lord's truth. Goodness knows. Spare the rod and spoil the child. As a good book says, I'm a land of sin and suffering for us both. I know he spoke of old Scratch, but laws ain't me. He's my own dead sister's boy, poor thing, and I ain't got the heart to lash him. However, every time I let him off, my conscience does hurt me so, and every time I hit him, my old heart most breaks. Well, a wild man that is born of woman is of few days and full of trouble, as the scripture says, and I reckon it's so. He played hooky this evening, or I'll play hooky this evening, and I'll just be obligated to make him work tomorrow to punish him. It's mighty hard to make him work Saturdays when all the boy is having, when all the boys is having holiday, but he hates work more than he hates anything else, and I've got to do some of my duty by him, or I will be ruination of the child. Tom did play hooky, and he had a very good time. He got back home barely in season to help Jim. The small colored boy saw him next. Days wood and split the kinings before supper. At least he was there in time to tell his adventures to Jim, while Jim did 3/4 of work. Tom's younger brother, or rather half-brother Sid, was already through with his part of work, picking up chips, for he was a quiet boy and had no adventures, troublesome ways, while Tom was eating his supper and stealing sugar as opportunity offered. Aunt Polly asked him questions that were full of glide and very deep, for he said, "Sydney, I don't thank you for that." It ain't safe place. Tom examined two large needles, which were thrust into the lapels of his jacket, and had thread bound around them. One needle carried white thread, the other black. He said, "She never noticed it. Hadn't been for Sid. Confronted it. Sometimes she sews it with white. And sometimes she sews it with black. I wish to." Misfortunes are forgiven or forgotten in the excitement of new enterprise. The new entrance was very valued, nobly in whistling, which he had just required from a Negro, and he was suffering to practice it undisturbed, inconsistent any pea cellar bird-like turn, a sort of liquid warabi produced by touching the tongue to the top of the mouth. Short intervals in the midst of the music, the reader probably remembers how to do it. If he has ever been a boy, deliberacy and attention soon gave him the lack of it, and he strode down the street with his mouth full of harmony and his soul full of gratitude. He felt much as a astronomer feels who has discovered a new planet, no doubt as far as strong, deep, allowing pleasure is concerned. The average was with the boy, not the astronomical. The summer evenings were long. It was not dark yet. Presently, Tom checked his whistle. A stranger was behind him, a boy a shade larger than himself, a newcomer of any age or either sex. a splendid marvel, the higher he turned up his nose at this furry, fennery, and the shabber, his own outfit. Their boy spoke. If one moved, the other moved, but only sideways in a circle. They kept face to face and eye to eye all the time. Finally, Tom says, "I can lick you. I'd like to see you try it. Well, I can do it." "No, you can't either." "Yes, I can." "No, you can't." "I can." "You can't." "Can't." "Can." "Can't." An uncomfortable pause. Then Tom said, "What's your name?" "'Tisn't any of your business, maybe." Say. anybody that takes a dare will steal sheep. The new boy stepped over proudly and said, "Now, you said you'll do it. Now let's see you do it. Don't you crown me. You better look out. Well, you said you'd do it. Why don't you do it?" "By jingles, for 2 cents, I'll do it." The new boy took 2 broad coppers out of his pocket and held them with their resin. Presently, the confession took form, and through the fog of battle, Tom appeared, settled, astride the new boy, pounding him with his best fist. "Hard enough," he said. The boy only struggled to free himself. He was crying, mainly from rage. And the pounding went on. At least the stranger got out a smothered nuff, and Tom let him up and said, "Now that you learn, better look out who you're fooling with next time." The new boy went off, brushing the dust from his clothes, sobbing, sniffing, and occasionally looking back, shaking his head and threatening what he would do to Tom the next time. He caught him out, which Tom responded with cheers and started off in high feathers. And as soon as his back was turned, the new boy snatched up a stone, threw it, and hit him between his shoulders, and then turned tail and ran like an antelope. Tom chased the traitor home and thus found where he lived. He then held position at the gate for time, daring the enemy to come outside. But the enemy only made faces at him through the window and declined. At last, the enemy's mother appeared and called Tom a bad, furious watcher child and ordered him away. So he went away, but he said he loathed to lay for that boy. He got home pretty late that night, and when he climbed cautiously in at the window, he uncovered an ambush in person of his aunt. When she saw the state of his clothes.